Okay, I want to teach a little bit. We are in 1 Corinthians, and if you're making notes, and I hope you're making some notes, your gaze determines how you build. Your gaze determines how you build. And what I want to do this morning is I just want to give a context. I want to speak in general terms as a framework, and then I want to work back through Corinthians. And I want to show you what it is to build, of course, with gold, silver, and precious stones. And we finished that on Wednesday night. And then this morning, I'm going to talk to you about what it is to build with wood, hay, and straw or stubble. And we need to understand these things because Paul was very insistent on letting the Corinthian church know that we must be wise builders with what we've been given. How many of you know that what you have been given in Christ cannot be bought? It cannot be attained in the world. It cannot in any way. I mean, there's a few guys tried to buy the anointing in the book of Acts. It is so precious what you've been given. But I wonder sometimes if we understand how important the big picture is. Because we can get caught up in the small things of our life, can't we? How many of us can get drilled down in the day-to-day things and all of a sudden the world just seems to overwhelm us, but we lose sight of the big picture. We lose sight of our gaze because we've set our gaze on other things. And this is really important because we'll see a progression that I'll take you through of Isaiah 2 and Isaiah 60 of where you set your gaze in this hour is going to be really, really important as things progress towards the culmination of the ages. We are moving towards Jesus returning. We are moving towards Jesus returning. We are far closer today than we were a year ago. We must understand that Jesus is coming back for his bride. It is a promise as sure as Scripture itself. What does that mean? In our heart, it shouldn't create fear. It should create faith and joy. It should create that great hope of great. Wow, everything is going to be culminated in the end. He's going to come. And that focus is really important. But there's another focus we need to understand of what it is to live in eternal life now. So eternal things are not just coming. The eternal things have also come. And I want to talk about that a little bit this morning. So we need to understand that there is a development of God's purposes on the earth towards the fulfillment of what he said would happen. Every generation takes a step in that direction and has a responsibility to take a further step than the previous generation. Every generation builds upon the other generation that's gone before it. And what is really important all through the Bible is that God's government would increasingly come to earth as it is in heaven. That although it looks dark for a while, there will be an increasing of the government of light, of the knowledge of the glory of God, would increase and increase. That means that something has to shift and something has to be dispelled. And we have to understand that darkness is never greater than light unless you empower it in your life. And so what you're connected to is a greater reality, is a new life, is a new light. So that life is light. And it's meant to be developed in you and built in you in a way that increasingly dispels the darkness and shifts the atmosphere, not just within you, but around you. And there is a law in the things of the Spirit that is an exponential power starts to come upon a community that works together with one heart and one mind. There is an exponential development. It's not just merely addition, it's multiplication. Yeah. It's exponential. That when two come together, it's an exponential increase. When three come together, even more. And I would hate to do the math, but it doesn't need to be a big community to shift the dynamics of a city. It just needs to be united, committed, unified, heart, community in a reality that is greater than the present reality we're living in. And so God has called us to take a stewardship or a responsibility. He's given us a trust. He's put things in our hands that belong to Him. And He is not afraid for you to make a mistake in developing it. You see, what happens often is our fear of failure impedes us from the realities of fulfillment in faith. A lot of F's there.
Fabulous.
Fabulous. Thank you, Gary. Very fruitful of you. So we need to know what it is in our life, how to build with it, how to develop it, and how to build together. You see, you can have the most spectacular life, but if you don't know how to build with somebody else, you're not revealing the Christ life.
Yeah.
You can be the most anointed man, the most gifted woman. You can be the bee's knees. But if you don't know how to partner and team with people, you've not yet allowed the love of God to fill your heart. See, teamwork is simply an overflow. It's simply an overflow of the heart of God beating in your heart. You want to be with people. You want to work together towards a common goal. And God has made it that way, that no one person gets there by themselves. No one generation has it all. But from generation to generation, as this thing grows and increases, and as we commit ourselves to it and we build towards something, something shifts, something starts to take place. And that's called light becoming greater than darkness. It's called a mountain that is rising. We are the mountain of the Lord. And what's important is we need to know the knowledge of the glory. What is the knowledge of the glory? This is so confusing to so many charismatic people. The knowledge of the glory is Jesus Christ. The knowledge of the glory is Jesus Christ. And when the knowledge of the glory is known, see, the knowledge of the glory is going to cover the earth. And God has used you and I to be the vessels, His real body, to radiate that knowledge into the world. But if we don't know Him, we can't radiate Him. So it's really important that we know what it is we're actually doing with our salvation. So often we've learnt through various circles and various traditions that salvation, it's all about me going to heaven later on. I want to tell you that through the journey of Hebrews, we should now be coming to the conclusion that it's not about a future reality only, it's about a future present reality. That through salvation, we've been invited into the age to come. We've been invited in now to eternal life. What is eternal life? John 17 tells us, knowing Him, knowing Jesus in the person of the Holy Spirit. So this is a pursuit that is so important for the church. It is the primary pursuit from which every secondary thing flows out of. But if that pursuit is not being pursued, we will put secondary things first and first things last. In other words, we will start to build our life with wood, hay, and straw instead of gold, silver, and precious gems. Does that make sense? Let's have a look at John 1, and I want to take you through something of an outline, and then we're going to jump into Corinthians. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being. In Him was life. In Him. Not in my nice new car, not in my nice new house, not in my nice new whatever. Anything made of the world comes from the author and the perfecter of our faith. It comes from the Creator God, Him. In Him is life. True life. See, we were designed for this life in Christ. This is actually what we were created for. We were created to carry this life of God and radiate it into the world. Then sin came into the world. Deception fell upon man. Sin came into the world. Then Jesus came to restore us and redeem us all the way back so we could get on with what God said he was going to fulfill. So we have to see, we can't do it outside of this life. Apart from him, there is no life. In him, there is the fullness of life. And that's why Paul talks so often in his epistles about this unction, this joining, this in Christ, this union with Christ. This union with Christ is the life flow for every single believer. Satan and hell will try and rock that connection, will try and get your gaze off of that connection, will try and rattle you into looking somewhere else and getting your mind off of where it should be, setting your heart away from where it should be. But where your heart and your thoughts, your affections are set on Christ in the Holy Spirit, there is an unbreakable union of life flow coming in through your life. And as you give yeses to it, as you give obedience to it, as you humble yourself to it, it radiates out through every part of your life. This gospel is amazing. And there is no life of what God intended apart from Jesus. He is the Father of life. He's everlasting Father. In other words, he became the source. The word Father there in the Hebrew means source. He is the source of life. So our gaze, when it's on Jesus, apprehends and pulls into our reality that life. And it keeps flowing and flowing and flowing until you get streams of living water flowing from you. God doesn't want you full to have a trickle. He wants you overflowing with him wherever you go, whatever you do, however you do it, because your heart is connected to his heart, your life is connected to his life, and you've learned how to flow in him. That's the point. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines into darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Shame. Shame. The Redeemer King had come, and he brought with him his kingdom, and they didn't recognize it. It was prophesied and prophesied and prophesied. But they didn't recognize it. So we see that what's important is that the Eternal One defines the eternal realm. The eternal realm, which is the kingdom realm, is its culture, its heartbeat, its administration, is all from God. It's all from his very being. He radiates his being out into action, creativity, and expression. Oh my goodness, are you getting the picture? Out of him comes everything. He's already seen it in his heart. He's already seen you in his heart. He's already written the books concerning you. He knew who you would be. And he wasn't ashamed. In fact, he calls you his glorious inheritance in Christ Jesus. To him, you are something special. You are his poetry. You are his creativity. None of you are meant to be the same. Hello? Yeah. Stop competing with each other. Stop trying to look like somebody else. Start being you. Connected to God, because the multifaceted wisdom of God is first revealed to principalities and powers. But the multifaceted wisdom of God, that multifaceted diamond, has many shapes. It reflects many different lights. It has different sounds, different tones, different color. That's called individuality in the body of Christ. But it's not meant to be a spirit of division. It's meant to be in a spirit of unity. Are you with me? So this eternal one is in us. So when we get saved, when we get born again, we die out of this world, but we now come in to the age to come, the eternal realm. Now the eternal world is in you, as much as the eternal one is in you. like I said, I'm not waiting to die to go home. I'm waiting to find home in me. I'm finding home in the Father. That's what that song means. We find home in the heart of the Father. That's why the Hebrews writer, I think it's Paul, is so insistent in saying, hey, what are you doing? Don't go back to those old religious ways. Come in to the new and living way. Come right in to the heart of the Father. That's where you came from. That's where you're going back to. And that's where you can live from. Heart of the Father. But the only way we can live in the heart of the Father is through the connected, the continuing connected life in Christ. In Christ. Living by the Spirit in Christ. In other words, He becomes my focus. He becomes my perspective. He becomes my world. And in that world, I will have the Holy Spirit and I will have the Father. The fullness of the Godhead moving and having their being and moving in and through me. Why? Because through the eternal realm within you, you produce the kingdom around you. But you need to give expression to that life. That's why faith has to have action. Faith has to have action. I love God, but I can't stand people. 1 John says, you're a porcupine. You're kidding yourself. Because the evidence that you love God is an expression. The evidence of that life is found in an expression. I don't try and get the expression to get the life. But the life produces an expression. Are we called to co-create? Anyone? Yes. Isn't that what Adam did in the glory? Co-created. Hey, Adam, what are you going to call my creation? What name do you... You see, a name in Hebrew thought says you defined its characteristics and its government. You determined its future. Adam, you determined. Co-labor with me. So many of us are still laboring for God instead of laboring with God. We are to co-labor with God. We are not His equal. Here's the promise. When you come to Christ... And when we come into this salvation and we step into eternal life, Jesus promises He'll do the heavy lifting. Yep. We are lifting things, Jesus says, only I can lift. We in this relationship, we learn that what looks impossible, Jesus says, that's okay, it's possible for me. Yeah. Just trust me in it, I'll get it done. That's co-laboring. And then co-laboring is where God will say, hey, what do you want to do? What do you think should happen? What do you want to co-create? Release that poetry in you. Every one of you's got a poetry, but it's got to be released. You will not flourish until we know how to receive and release the life flow of God. We've got to know both how to receive it and release it. And so often we labor and as an exaggeration on one or the other. We either, I just love receiving God. I do. I mean, it's easier to stay there. Let's be honest. It's a whole lot easier just to lock yourself away, get in the presence and the Word every day, and go, gee, what life's so amazing. Well, you haven't challenged anything. You haven't shifted anything except your heart. And if your heart's not shifting there, what are you doing there? But if you're going to be there from the presence, from that secret place, you build yourself up into Him. Why? So you can carry Him into the world. Yeah. To carry Him into a relationship. To carry Him into the workplace. To carry Him through your generosity, through your serving. By going low when somebody wants to knock your block off. Forgiving when somebody's just being really, really nasty. Do you see what I'm saying? How you build is really, really important. Are you with me? So, we have this eternal life now. And it's quite obvious from where we've been teaching that the heart of the matter is the heart. The heart's a really big deal, isn't it? Jesus spoke about the heart. Ezekiel said, I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to take out that old, arrogant, prideful one, that one that's not teachable, and I'm going to give you a soft, childlike, teachable heart, soft, fleshy heart. I'm going to put my spirit in it so that your spirit and my spirit in your heart can help develop you to become who I always thought you could become, to do what I always knew you could do from generation to generation. Isn't that amazing? So we see then the heart of the matter is learning to see who we are and then learning to see what we're meant to do. Because being should flow into doing. If we're doing, 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 and there's no being, where's the life flow? A lot of us are doing to get recognition for God. That is wood, hay, and straw. When you have positioned yourself in Christ and He is the pursuit, He is the connection, and you start to mirror Him because you behold Him. That's what worship does. Who you, what you worship is what you'll become. So as your heart and affections go there, as your gaze goes there, what happens naturally is the Spirit will lead you to things you might not have otherwise thought about or you thought you couldn't, wouldn't, or shouldn't do. It will start to move you in the way of the kingdom instead of the way of the world. And that's what Paul teaches. He says the flesh, the self-life, is opposed to the things of the Spirit. He said, but if you walk by the Spirit, you can overcome that pull back to the old life. You can come into the eternal life now. Making sense? Why is that so important? Because in Isaiah 2, this is what is prophesied. Now it will come about that in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. Who is Isaiah prophesying about? The church, you and I. You and I. Now, if you look in the natural realm, if you're getting your read from the world, this seems a long, long, long way off. Would anyone agree with me this morning? But are we meant to get our read from the world? We're meant to be in the world, but not of the world. It's not our focus. It's not our game plan. That's not where we get our read. Where do we get our read? From God, from His Word, from His living Word, Jesus Christ, through a fresh Word, through the Holy Spirit, through the precepts and the principles of the Word. The Word is truth and it is life. Jesus said, these words I speak to you are truth and they are life. So if we want truth and life to be light, we need truth and life to be light, and we rise in it, we've got to build that into our life. You seeing it? We've got to build. So we co-labor with that reality in our life. And then our yeses become building blocks. Our obedience become building blocks in us getting established into who we're meant to come. Our unity become building blocks to become a mountain together. Because there's a mighty mountain that's meant to rise. Let's have a look at it. Now it will come about in the last days, the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. That means there's other mountains. There's other spheres of authority. What are those other spheres of authority if there's only one mountain of light? They're mountains of darkness. They're mountains or spheres of influence in society. We are to rise so as to influence every other mountain or realm of spiritual authority in the world. And we'll be raised above the hills, and all the nations, all the peoples will stream to it. And many peoples will come and say, come, let us go up the mountain of the Lord to the house of the God of Jacob, that He may teach us concerning His ways, that we may walk in His paths. His paths bring life. When we walk in His paths, I've taught this before, life follows us. When you walk in the paths of God, the whole of the kingdom is following you. The whole of the king. Oh my goodness me. When you halak in the Spirit and you walk by the Word as a reality of truth and life in your life, it presently guiding you, it is a lamp to your feet and it is a light, so it gives you the present and the future. You're constantly moving between the present and the future. We're not stuck in the present. If you get bogged down in the present, you're going to lose your sight for the future. If you get lost in the future, there's no reality in the present. We've got to be present, future, future, present in our walk. Am I making sense this morning? And as we walk in it, the whole of the kingdom is following us. Guess what? Then we start to rise up together. As you're walking, you're rising. It's not linear, it's circular, and it goes up and up to the top of the mountain. You're meant to live out of the presence of God in the glory. That's the eternal realm within you. For the law will go forth from Zion. Zion's not on earth. It's in heaven. See the shift. He's talking about practical mountains on the earth, but where is it? Where's the legislation going to come from? Out of Zion. Guess what? That's the new and living way, because you now have come to heavenly Jerusalem. Hebrews. You have now come. That's where your life is positioned. That is where you get your gaze from. That's where the prophetic and the legislative comes from. It comes from that which is already in the unseen spiritual realm of the glory with the Father. We don't have to prophesy into the atmosphere. We prophesy from another atmosphere. We start to decree things from God's heart. Why? Because He's going to show us. He wants to show us those things. This Isaiah 2 is the reality of what Jesus spoke about in Matthew 16. This is a church that's God's legislative assembly that know how to bind and loosen. They know how to legislate things into being. Why? Because they already are in heaven. They know how to shut things down on earth. Why? Because they're shut down in heaven. Oh my goodness, I want some of that. Who wants to walk in that? So how we build, how we become, and what we do really matters to God's major plans and purposes. Would that be fair? And God is so just. He says, on the way, I'll reward those. I'll reward those who actually trust me in this. I'll reward them. Even when it looks like it's not counting. Ching, ching. Remember last Sunday? Ching, ching in heaven. Brr, brr on earth. Ching, ching in heaven. I want the ching ching. Who wants some ching ching? I want the ching ching. I want the ching ching. Isaiah 60 says, arise, shine. You know what that means? Wakey, wakey. Hello, anyone there? Get off your mat and walk. Arise. Are you with me? Now, arising means you come into action. 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 What does action look like? It looks like me doing something as I'm rising. But I don't know what to do. Well, just love somebody. Just go love somebody. I don't know. Just go love the person in front of you. Go low and go love them. Yeah. Start there. I'm really not sure. Well, just start serving somewhere. See, all of this kingdom life comes on the way. God just wants you to arise and shine. Yeah. He just wants you. He just wakey wakey off the couch. Off the couch. Yeah. Let's go, church. That's really what he's saying here. Yeah. For your light has come. Whose light? Your light. Who's the light? John chapter 1. For the light of the world. Who's that? Jesus. Jesus has come. Therefore, it's wakey wakey. Do you see that? How long ago was Jesus on the earth? A while ago, would you say? Okay. And how long ago was it that he was resurrected into the glory and sent us the Holy Spirit? A while ago. Ever since then, it's been wakey wakey. Ever since Jesus rose into the glory, Isaiah 60 was a true statement of being fulfilled. We are in an Isaiah 60 development. Do you see that? For and the glory of the Lord has risen upon who? Upon you. So that you can be the light. For behold, darkness will cover the earth and deep darkness the people. See that? It'll cover the earth in its systems, in its patterns, in its worldly events and attitudes. And it'll cover people. What does that mean? A spirit of oppression, the spirit of hopelessness, the spirit of I can't. I tell you, the Spirit of God says, I can, and I have a hope, and I have a future. I'm not a nobody. I'm a somebody called to live as light, uncommon in the common. Guys, it's time to be the standouts. But how you build will determine what you rise to. Do you understand? But the Lord will rise upon you and His glory will appear upon you. Prophetic statement of fulfillment. God is looking to rise upon a people that are willing to build in the right way. And so that then you can sort of start seeing that when Paul's talking to the Corinthians, he's really concerned as a father. See, immaturity is a concern. Because it locks you out of the prophetic fulfillment of God's promises and prophetic fulfillment of His purposes on the earth. Now, when we look at the book of Corinthians, we can go, oh, that was then. When I look at the book of Corinthians, I see the modern church, the modern Western church in particular. And it troubles me. It troubles my own life. So I go, gee, what am I doing? What am I building with? What are we building with? How are we building? Are we building what Jesus is building, or are we building our own thing? What are we meant to be building? And what's going to last? What's going to be there at the end of the day? You know, it's a bit like you investing most of your life into something that you thought would be enduring, only to realize it got burnt. Just got burnt up. And then you stand before God, you got nothing to say about that because it didn't survive. All you got to talk about with God is what comes through the flames. 1 Corinthians 3:12. Now, if any man builds on the foundation with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw, each man's work will become evident. For the day will show it, because it is to be revealed with fire, and the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. If any man's work, which he has built on it, remains... See that? If it remains, all good. He will receive a reward. If any man's work is burnt up, he will suffer loss. But he himself will be saved, yet is through fire. What does Revelation say? So that we can bring the context. Then I saw a great throne and him who sat upon it, from whose presence earth and heaven fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, the great and the small, standing before the throne, and the books, plural, were opened. So that's one kind of books. And then another book, singular, was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged from the things that were written in the books, the first books, according to their deeds, action. Now, here's the thing. God not only measures our actions, but our motivation. God judges the heart. That's where we've got to get that right in doing this. So if we're still doing things for our reputation, for you make our name great, and our ministry, our this, mine, there's a fair chance the motivation of the heart is not right. That's not going to survive. But when the motivation of the heart is moving by the Spirit, by faith, by love, by doing those things that God's called you to do to release, guess what? Gold and silver and precious stones. Now, here's the thing about precious stones. Precious stones are precious. Would that be fair? Isn't it funny, on the ephod, on the chest plate of the high priest that went into the glory, precious stones, 12. and they are inscribed with a name for each of the tribes of Israel, 12 tribes. Each stone precious before God. Yep. And what's he saying? He says, my body is my precious inheritance. You are precious and you are valuable. So when we start to see each other as precious and valuable, how God sees, we reveal his heart for one another. Guess what happens? We start to encourage one another. We start to stir each other. We start to guide one another. And the strong come alongside of the weak, Paul says, and we start to build together. I mean, who wants some of that? But it's got to be a decision on us, how we. It's not going to just float in the ether and happen. I have to make a conscious decision about how I want to build. I have to be intentional about where I set my gaze and then what's going to be my response. And sometimes I'm going to be asked to do things that I didn't think I have the capacity for. Sometimes I'm going to be asked to do things I really don't want to do because I don't feel like it. Doesn't fit with how I feel today. See, the problem with this Corinthian church, it was all about its own sensuality. The problem with the Corinthian church was it worshipped for itself. Its gifts were about how good they were. They had a complete misunderstanding about worship, spiritual gifts, how to operate in community. Basically, it was a bit of a mess. Yet they'd all received the same message. What was the problem? How they were building. And how you build has to be intentional. How many of you know you have to lay a foundation? Right, now who puts the bricks in the wall? Do you get a builder in? Well, you're the brickie. There's no other laborer for your life. I'm not your laborer. I can build with you, but I can't build for you. You have to build your... Oh my goodness. You have to take responsibility how you build. That's what Paul says to them. You have to take responsibility for how you build. Don't blame the guy at the front or the girl at the back or your mum or your dad or I didn't have this and I didn't have that. You've got to settle that in your heart so that you can build. All good. All right, so setting our gaze on Jesus, we are building with wood, hay, and straw. Well, it's claiming that it's worldly, isn't it? I mean, that's just going to burn. Anything worldly is going to burn. But I want to re-emphasize this. Building for an eternal reward means you are living from the eternal realm now. You are living from the age to come, the life of the Spirit, the life of Christ in you now. That means I'm not looking out there to get my read. I'm looking up and in. I'm seeing what the Word says about God. I'm seeing what the Word says about me. I'm seeing what the world says about my potential. I'm seeing what the Word says about what I have. I'm understanding the power of my redemption. I'm understanding this power of my salvation. And I'm learning that I'm an overcomer, not a giver-upper. That means I might have to persevere a while. It might mean I have to stay the line when I'm not seeing it all broken down. Why? Because every yes in obedience to Jesus, in perseverance, waiting in preparation, is a ching, ching, ching in heaven. God is faithful. He never said it was going to be a picnic. Ever. And he never said Christianity was going to be comfortable. And it's certainly not going to be comfortable when light and dark have a bit of a collision. But can I tell you this? We've got to find peace in God in the tribulation. We're not meant to be caught up in the calamity. We're meant to be caught up in Christ. Does that make sense? Yes, that's going on. Yes, it's very real. Yes, it's trying to impact my world. But I choose another way. I choose to be self-governing and responsible. I choose to respond God-like, Christ-like in this crisis. Amen? Am I encouraging you or not? 1 John talks about what it is to be in the world. And I love 1 John because it's a very important book. John, when this is written, is probably at the end of his life. He's very, very old. He's been around a long time. And he's watched each of the other apostles be martyred. You think about that. And now he's writing to the church at Ephesus. He was really a pastor. He was on the, probably might be on the island of Patmos, but he certainly was their pastor. And he was writing to them as an old man. And this message is so powerful because of this. This is a man that laid on Jesus' chest. This is a man that was with Jesus when he walked the earth. This is a man that has got the deepest memories of those 3 years. He's been with the one who was uniquely human, yet uniquely God. He is dealing with error that had crept into the church, wrong teaching that shifted the gaze and shifted the foundation of the church at Ephesus. Wasn't it warned? You've lost your first love. It's lost its gaze. It lost its pursuit. He's writing as an old man to another generation to say, I was there with him. This is not a story. It's not a philosophy. I touched him. I felt him. I loved him. He loved me. I looked after his mom. I was the one at the cross. I was the only one at the cross. I saw it all. And I'm telling you, this is what's important. Hey, I want to listen. Yeah. Don't you want to listen to a guy like that? Wow. So what he says is really, really important. And he says, you can't be in love with the world if you want to walk with Jesus. You can't have your affections and your life being trapped in the world if you want to walk with Jesus. If you want to walk in this life, you have to have some personal integrity and make a decision. Not everything goes. It's a choice. The Message translation talks about loving the world. He said, I remind you, my dear children. How's that, eh? Just such a father. Such a father. Your sins are forgiven in Jesus' name. You veterans, I'm reading from the Message. You fathers, I think it is, were in on the ground floor and know the one who started all of this. Remember? He's saying, remember? And you newcomers have won a victory over the evil one. That's your first position. But it's not a fake victory. It's a real victory. How can you have that kind of victory? Because you have been now brought up into a new and living way. You are in a position of living by a greater eternal reality in you now. And that anointing is greater than anything in the world. If you will let it guide you, if you let it empower you, if you have a yes to it. See, there's no point having a power in you if you don't use it. When are you going to use the power? When there's an obstacle, when there's a pull, when there's an attraction to something and you're losing your gaze, you go, whoop, I've got the power to set the gaze, I've got the power to overcome. I've got the power to be free every step I take. See, because when I engage the world, I go back into bondage. When I walk with Jesus, I stay free. Who wants bondage? Who wants freedom? And a second reminder, dear children, you know the Father from personal experience. You veterans know the one who started it all, and you newcomers, such vitality and strength. God's word is so steady in you. Your fellowship with God enables you to gain a victory over the evil one. Don't love the world's ways. Don't love the world's goods. Love of the world, listen to this, squeezes out love for the Father. Ever had a little competition go on in your world? World, Father, world, Father. Goes on, doesn't it? Every day. Practically everything that goes on in the world, wanting to get your own way, wanting everything for yourself, wanting to appear important, has nothing to do with the Father. Wow. That is a massive lesson and life adjustment from the one who lays on Jesus' chest. The apostles had to learn this. It didn't happen in 2 seconds. They had to learn it. And you look at the way Peter writes by the end of his life. What did he learn? Things of the world don't matter. They're going to fade. They're going to burn. Now, do we have to be in the world? Sure, we do. Do we have to be responsible, pay our bills, and be a good citizen? Of course we do. We should. We should be an uncommon good citizen. Amen? Yeah. We've got to do that stuff. But what is your heart and your affections really going after? Where are you really setting your gaze? That is what's determining your life. Yeah. And the encouragement from John is simple. Keep your gaze on Jesus. Oh, I was with him. I touched him. He's very real, very human. I ate with him. We're in the same digs together. This Jesus is very, very real. But at the same time, he's every bit God. Every bit God. And he can. So when you let his life come into your life will change to give life wherever you go. What are you building? Matters here, and it matters when we stand before God. I encourage you, be faithful. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Set your gaze, set your heart, remain fixed to the course, and watch all of heaven follow you in as we build together. Amen? Let me pray for you. Father, I just thank you so much of what you're revealing to our hearts. I thank you so much for this morning. And I know that you're speaking into our hearts more and more and more. Yes. And Lord, you are good. You are powerful. And above all, you see us as valuable to you. Every single one of us is valuable to you. And you're a good father and you want to produce children after your image and your likeness, just like Jesus. And Lord, we have chosen that life because that life engaged our life. We said yes to salvation. We said yes to Jesus, that we would be changed forever. And so, Lord, I ask for that life to just increase, for your anointing to increase upon us, in us and through us. Lord, just help us make good decisions in this decision. Empower us in your love, truth, and life to walk the walk. To live the life that will reveal your glory, that we rise as light into the darkness. In Jesus' name. Bless you. Amen. Amen.